Welcome all to the new season of this SIB Virtual Computational Biology Seminar Series. Today we have the pleasure to host Bart Desplanck from the Laboratory of Systems Biology and Genetics at the PFL. This group is also affiliated to the SIB Swiss Institute of Bioinformatics since 2013. Bart grew up in Belgium, where he studied biochemical engineering at the University of Ghent. In 2002, he got his PhD in immunobiology at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in the US. Bart then did a first postdoc jointly at the Department of Cancer Biology, Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and the Department of Genetics of the Harvard Medical School in Boston, Massachusetts. In 2003, he did a second postdoc at the University of Massachusetts Medical School in Worcester, in the Massachusetts as well. And in 2007, he decided to move back to Europe, and he became assistant professor in systems biology and genetics at the Institute of Bioengineering, School of Medical of Life Science at the PFL. And since 2014, he's an associated professor in his lab. So at the Laboratory of Systems Biology and Genetics, Bart and his team use high-throughput sequencing, single-cell genomics, microfluidics, large-scale yeast screening, and computational approaches to characterize the regulatory code in Drosophila and in mammals. And also is interested in examining how this variation in this code affects molecular and organismal diversity. So in addition to their research interest, the group is also actively interested in developing new research tools and pipelines that enable a better characterization of gene regulatory networks. So today, Bart will give us a primer to single-cell gene expression analysis. So Bart, thank you again for accepting this invitation, and the floor is yours.
Thanks much, Diana. So I actually look forward to this because I think it's not going to be your conventional talk talking about our own data. But in fact, I decided to give a more technical talk to introduce you to the difficulties that are typically associated with single cell analyses. I think many of us are really excited about the potential of these single cell analyses, but there's a lot of caveats that one needs to take into account. It's also a very rapidly evolving field, so I kind of predict that many of the methodologies that I will show now that we're trying to implement in order to deal with these very complex data might be already outdated actually in a couple of years. And so many methodologies as we speak are being developed to deal with the single cell analysis. Now I also immediately want to thank very much two senior postdocs, outstanding postdocs in the lab, Petra Schwally and Vincent Gardeux, who actually set up a single cell biology course last year. And it's from this course that I assembled a series of slides, in fact condensed a series of slides, and hopefully will introduce you to some of the complexities of single cell analysis. And so again, thanks to them, a big thanks to them. So why single cell analysis? Well, I think we're all aware that basically the genome encodes a remarkable complexity of phenotypes, cell types, and organs, systems, and so forth, right? There's remarkable cellular diversity and specialization, and you can see some of the well-known systems here. And we're slowly but steadily actually coming to grips with the sheer complexity that we're facing, in that our body tends to have more than 100 trillion cells. And so far, we've kind of defined them as 200 types of cells. But I think we all realize that so far, we've only scratched the surface. And more do we see these very intricate interactions between cells that seem to be driven by different identities of the interacting cells. However, we have a very little understanding of what these identities particularly are. And that this needs to be mapped and resolved has been recognized actually by many funding agencies, not only official ones, but also actually private ones, such as, for example, the newly generated Chan Zuckerberg BioHub, which actually has pledged $600 million actually to start mapping the human cell atlas. And this is an initiative that probably will go underway by next year. At least part of the $600 million will be devoted to that. So going back to these tissues, indeed, so far gene expression has been really good at defining what tissues look like, at least molecularly, right? This tissue identity is captured by gene expression to the extent, indeed, that gene expression patterns are more similar across homologous tissues of different species than between diverse tissues of the same species, okay? And so there's been great advances also to actually try to understand the regulatory mechanisms that lead to these particular systems or tissues. But there's also great limitations that are associated with genomic applications, namely minimum starting material requirements, and the technique is typically applied on millions of cells, which therefore leads us to the big caveat in all these analyses in that everything is averaged, right? We're always looking at a liver in a way as an average system, not a system of hundreds of millions of different cell types, okay? And moreover, rare cell types and states are typically not analyzed because they typically disappear basically in the mass of gene expression data that are being generated. So again, I want to emphasize here, each sample that we look at with bulk RNA sequencing or bulk transcriptomics is an average, and we have no idea of the underlying values in single cells or of the heterogeneity of the specific tissue. And this is also somewhat nicely illustrated here with a simple cartoon from a nice review in that here, for example, you have the bars representing bulk analysis, but if you look a bit more carefully, you can see that gene blue, for example, is only expressed in those three cells and not in the other. However, the bulk analysis, you will not notice that, right? And I recently came across an interesting analogy in that bulk RNA sequencing is actually compared to trying to dissect a smoothie, whereas what you really want to know is actually the fruit that actually is in the smoothie, right? I think it kind of brings the message really nicely home. And so what is single cell analysis trying to do? Well, we're trying to actually identify rare cell types, right, from early development to stem cells or circulating tumor cells in the blood as a diagnosis or a diagnostic tool. We'd like to look at heterogeneity in tissue composition, cancer. We also like to understand temporal processes of differentiation, which I think can be better resolved using single cell analysis. Gene regulatory networks can also better be inferred using single cell analysis because you're dealing with non-confounded correlations. And finally, something that I'm not going to cover here, of course, there's also very interesting phenomena at the single cell level that need to be studied, such as gene expression stochasticity or the appearance of monoallelic expression. A couple of already very nice examples. For example, here one looked at actually the early developmental programs in both mouse and in human. And what we found basically is what the researchers found, not we, but the researchers, is that transcriptome group cells, according to their developmental stage, so you can see this here, you can already see a kind of temporal pattern here in that you go from the oocyte actually to the marilla, and if you actually want to have some more information, this is illustrated here. And it seems that also each developmental stage is characterized by a small number of functional modules of co-expressed genes. And this is illustrated here. You can see that in these early developmental phases, first, you seem to have enrichment for protein transport, GTPA signaling, then transcription regulation, RNA processing, translation, and then mitochondrial synthesis. Now, something interesting that also appeared is that the developmental phases between human and mouse are, in fact, not entirely conserved, as can actually see here between the different cartoons, right? So here you have the pre-major zygote genomic activation, and here this is the embryo genomic activation. And so you can see that the stages actually differ a little bit as to when this exactly occurs. Okay, so the temporal developmental pattern is clearly different between mouse and human. Again, something that you can only grab when you actually study these things at a single cell level. Now, also recently, a very impressive paper actually by the Stan Linnerson group is actually the analysis of whole tissue from the brain, such as, for example, the somatosensory cortex, the hippocampus, where they actually analyzed thousands of cells, and this allowed them actually to, for the first time, get an incredible resolution of neuronal cell type hierarchies, which are actually listed here. And for each, basically, then there's actually specific transcription factors that were uncovered, again, showing you how you can actually then use single cell analyses to truly infer, basically, gene regulatory mechanisms. Some interesting findings also that came with this kind of analysis is that, for example, interneurons were found of similar type, but they were found actually in dissimilar regions of the brain. They were also able to identify oligodendrocytes subtypes, which is illustrated here. And they also were able to actually identify microglia associated with blood vessels and distinguish them from perivascular macrophages. All features basically that are particularly pertaining to the power of single cell analysis. So that brings me basically then to the core message of this presentation, which is to basically go through the kind of analysis that one needs to do in order to actually come up with these kind of findings that are illustrated here. And so I will assume that most of you here in the audience or who will be listening at least have some basic understanding of both RNA sequencing. And what I will do then, therefore, is to focus basically on what is this specifically particular or peculiar about single cell analysis, and so to emphasize that when you actually do these kind of analyses. So first, a very brief introduction to the experimental workflow. As you know, you need to first capture, of course, the cell before you can analyze it. Then you lyse it, then you reverse transcribe the mRNA, you pre-amplify because you actually work with very little amounts of mRNA. Then you do the library preparation, and then you proceed to sequencing. Okay. A couple of pointers here, there's actually many different techniques nowadays, from micromanipulation to FACS, microdroplets and microfluidics to capture these cells. At this point, what you can do also in reverse transcription, something I will come back to is actually the use of artificial RNA spike-ins in order to control better your data, or at least control the noise that will be in your data. And what you can also do is include unique molecular identifiers. I will come back to that in a moment, again, for reducing technical noise. And you can also include cell-specific barcodes that allow you then to multiplex, for example, thousands of cells in one sequencing run. Now, one often wonders basically how many cell sequencing reads one actually needs to, for example, really truly identify a cell or characterize molecularly a cell. And there's some consensus in the field, at least, that 1 million reads might be sufficient. In fact, there's even reports that 50,000 are already sufficient, at least if you just want to identify the cell type. If you really totally want to molecularly characterize the cell, probably 1 million is a more conservative estimate. Okay. So, single-cell RNA-seq versus population RNA-seq. So the global workflow, as I already stated, is actually similar, both experimentally and analytically, but there's really fundamental differences between the single-cell and population RNA-seq experiments that we need to consider in the analysis. Okay. First of all, here, population RNA-seq, you typically deal with less than 10 samples, and you also include replicates, and the starting material is typically millions of molecules which are stable across sample and time. And again, what we already discussed is that, of course, these are average measurements. Most genes also will be measured because you're actually contemplating an entire system, not one specific cell. And we assume that most genes, the expression of the genes is unchanged across conditions, right? These are a couple of assumptions that actually go into most of the analytical tools that you would use for a population RNA-seq. Now, the story is very different when you deal with single cells. Here you go to from 100 to nowadays almost routinely 10,000 cells that you analyze, so each cell actually contributes to transcriptome, okay? Each cell in a way is unique because it will actually present kind of different transcriptome, which whether this also is a different cell type is another question. The starting material is, of course, very limited. You will typically deal with less than 1 million molecules, and it tends to be highly variable across cells and time. There's also very highly variable measurements, such as physical stress. For example, certain cells experience stress when you fact sort them into a plate. The amount, of course, is also different. And again, all of these things can, for example, be controlled for using spike-in controls and unique molecular identifiers. And then very importantly, you're typically dealing with sparse data because many genes will be non-observed, either because they're not expressed or simply because, given the limited amount of starting material, you will simply miss them when you amplify your material. They're there, but after processing all your data, they basically were lost in the experimental or computational workflow. So that means that actually for the statisticians among you, you're dealing with a lot of zeros, and that presents actually a lot of problems, okay? So this is gonna be kind of the red line through this talk, right? So we're gonna go through the computational workflow that involves single cell RNA sequencing, and we're gonna start with the first layer of quality control and filtering. This is kind of relatively straightforward, okay? If you, for example, use a microfluidic device such as the Fluidyne, what you need to do is maybe make your cell fluorescence, ideally so that you can really detect it and make sure that there's indeed one cell there. You may have heard of the Fluidyne problems that actually they thought many of the cells were indeed unique, but then when they looked a bit closer, it turns out basically that cells were stacked. And so if you look from above, you would not see two cells, okay? So again, this actually just reveals a couple of biases, and of course, if you have two cells in one, this is a very different picture, okay? If you, for example, sort into plates, again, make sure you do a couple of run experiments so that you can actually look in your plate and see that most of the wells have one cell. If you, for example, see a lot of wells with no cells, that means that probably there's one well out there that has a lot of cells. So again, not good. So you need to control for that. Assuming that everything there goes well, then you can move to sequencing quality control. I'm not going to dwell on this because this is typically the same that you would do with bulk RNA-seq, you know, the kind of popular tools such as FastQC and so forth that deal with low sequencing, dead state cycles, GC biases, low complexity, and so forth. So I'm not going to cover this too much. So then, of course, we want to go to gene expression estimates, right? So we want to derive a count map matrix, which is basically gene by cell matrix. And so here, of course, you will have maybe thousands of cells, so this will be a very large matrix. And so how can you really get good count data? So what you, of course, need to do is align your reads to the genome, to the transcriptome, so you have reads and tag counts, okay? And here is also then where I will introduce the unique molecular identifiers, because, of course, you can only map those reads after you basically reverse transcribed your material and you are sequencing cDNA. So what are those unique molecular identifiers? If you haven't heard of them, what you can do is actually simply in the oligo-TT, for example, that aligns to the poly-A tail of your mRNA, you can include this kind of unique barcode, so to speak, UMI, right? That then will incorporate in each cDNA that is actually generated from each mRNA. So each mRNA, in a way, will have a unique UMI, right? So that means that basically, if you then look at your reads, and so, for example, as illustrated here, you have a lot of reads that represent the same transcript, but what you see then is that you actually count four UMIs. That means that there's an amplification bias there, right? That means that you actually amplify more than there is in reality, and so in reality, there are actually only four transcripts that represent or are represented by those UMIs, okay? The nice thing about those UMIs is that at the end, therefore, you get absolute count data. You know for sure that there are actually four mRNAs there, basically, of this particular species, okay? So this is the same here. So here you have 11 reads, but this is actually only corresponding to three because there's actually three UMIs that are actually represented there. So it means every time you see a UMI multiple times, it means there's an amplification bias, okay? Good. One little detail, though, is that UMIs also can have sequencing errors, okay? So most tools nowadays actually incorporate and allow for one mismatch. And this is important, and this is also how your primer should be designed, okay? And so now we have this molecular count matrix, which you can actually base on UMI. So UMIs are great. What is the problem? The problem is that actually some of the most routinely used the standard methods for single cell analysis, the most accepted, for example, such as SmartSeq, which does an entire transcript analysis in single cells, does not allow you to use UMIs, okay? Because they actually sequence both from the 5' end and the 3' end, right? So some of the most routinely used methods, unfortunately, do not incorporate UMIs. Something to think about when you design your experiment. We would favor, for example, only sequencing the 3' end because that allows you to incorporate UMIs. But it also means, of course, that any kind of splicing information you will miss because you will only sequence from the 3' end, okay? So going to quality control and filtering, the second step, okay? And here the goal is, what is really critical is that we go on the hunt for low quality cells that may skew downstream results, okay? So we really want to eliminate any kind of cell that looks suspicious. And this is a very difficult exercise because sometimes certain cell types look suspicious by nature and we might actually eliminate them inadvertently, okay? So what can we use for that? We can use the number of fraction of mapped reads. We can use the number of expressed genes per cell. So if that, of course, is low, then you might think that the cell actually is not of very high quality. You can also wonder where do the reads map, you know, certain genomic features. For example, if many reads map to mitochondrial genes, then something may have happened to the cell. For example, the cytoplasm may have leaked out. You may have lost the mRNA from the cytoplasm, but since the mitochondria still incorporate the mRNA, the only thing that you would actually see is actually RNA from the mitochondria. So if you see a lot of mitochondrial mapped reads, there's probably a quality issue. Similarly, if you actually spike in a known amount of mRNA and you see that most reads map to your spike-ins, well, then you know again that probably your endogenous mRNA is coming from your cell were either absent or very low quality. And so again, if there's a disproportional amount of reads mapping to your spike-ins, you want to actually probably eliminate that cell. You can also use the expression level of housekeeping genes, which is also a way or which is commonly used for normalizing. Again, if the expression levels of many housekeeping genes are suspiciously low, you probably want to eliminate this cell. Okay, and so actually the Teichmann group actually developed this kind of vector machine-based approach to identify low-quality cells. So it's kind of an all-in-one approach, and it automatically checks for all features and flags that basically allow you to remove low-quality cells, okay? And this has been done by training it on a lot of single-cell RNA-seq data from multiple studies, okay? So here is actually just a couple of depictions of what a low quality cell may look like. For example, here you have a fraction of a line reads per cell as in relation to the density. Of course, here basically this is suspiciously low. So again, there's a low mapping number per fraction, which can indicate low quality cells. And here you also have the number of mapped reads per cell versus the unmapped reads. And so for those where you have much more unmapped reads, again, those cells probably look very suspicious, and you might consider actually eliminating them from your analysis. Okay. So at the end, basically, a good quality measure also is how many genes actually do you see expressed? And this was somewhat counterintuitive to me in the beginning, and it was actually nice to see that, in fact, if you have a decent number of cells at least, if you take all the genes that you detected across all cells, it turns out basically that at an individual level, single cell, you have about 4,000 to 6,000 genes if the assay is done properly. But when you actually then take into account all the genes that you detected in those single cells, you typically find more genes expressed than if you would have taken all the cells and do a bulk analysis. Okay? So that again shows you the power of single cell analysis in a way that you detect transcripts that in a bulk analysis are completely missed. Okay? So a good quality measure is exactly that. What you want to see at the end of the day, indeed, that if you were to or have the capacity to compare it to a bulk RNA-seq sample, is that the single cell reconstructed population should in a way be, in terms of complexity, be equal or even better than your bulk RNA-seq sample. Okay? Also an important measure. Okay? And then we go to this very intriguing point of single cell analysis, which is basically that there might be systematic differences in the number of RNA molecules per cell. This is really common. And why might this be? Well, cells might not be equal in size, and there's of course a scaling factor here, right? Smaller cells might simply have less RNA, right? And therefore less cDNA, and it might be more difficult therefore to actually amplify that cDNA, okay? So this is illustrated here. Here you have a small embryonic stem cell, and here you have a fibroblast, okay? A mouse embryonic fibroblast, and this cell actually tends to be larger, and therefore you basically find on average much more mRNA molecules per cell than your smaller embryonic stem cell, okay? The problem though is, of course, here I nicely showed you the depiction of the two cells, so you will figure, one is smaller than the other, so I understand this data. The problem is that many of the cell types we're dealing with, we simply don't know what they are, and so we don't know a priori whether they're smaller, larger, or we don't know anything, because we just took actually sometimes 10,000 cells from the brain and we don't know actually how they look like, okay? So the real goal here is to actually try to distinguish technical artifacts, which could happen. Maybe, you know, this cell type is equally large, but maybe more difficult to lyse. You would have less cDNA, and you would kind of assume that this cell is smaller, even though actually in reality they're equal in size, okay? So the goal here really is to find out whether this is technical or experimental, and the amount of RNA, of course, in a cell is fundamentally linked to the cell type, but at the same time to the technical ability to obtain measurements. And so this kind of effect, therefore, can be both purely technical or biological, and so this has enormous downstream implications during analysis, for example, for normalization, clustering, and differential gene expression. And again, we would argue that spike-ins actually can aid in resolving this issue. So let's go to spike-ins, okay? So artificial RNA spike-ins can be added at a known concentration and volume, and so we know then for these spike-ins what the number of molecules are per cell, right? And so here we make a big assumption, namely that the endogenous transcript will behave similarly to the spike-ins. Now, there's already been reports that those spike-ins do not behave like the endogenous transcripts, unfortunately, and that basically the use of spike-ins can introduce yet another technical bias. But for all good measures, what we assume here is that they do actually resemble basically the endogenous transcript relatively well. And so now you have the number of molecules for each endogenous transcript, and thus the total number of molecules per cell can be estimated, which for mammalian cells ranges between 100,000 to 1 million molecules per cell. And so here what we plot basically is the mean estimated expression versus the spike in concentration, right? We know this information. And so what you can do here then is to actually, given a mean expression level of X, a transcript will therefore have a concentration I, which can be represented by a gamma distribution, as is actually can be really seen on this graph, right? To model this kind of distribution of molecular concentration. So the log concentration given the log, for example, fragments per kilobase per million. Okay. So using those spike-ins, you can therefore estimate a bit the number of molecules per cell, okay? And so now putting that together, you have on the one hand UMAIs, you have on the other basically spikens. So with the UMIs, you can actually estimate the number of transcribed molecules that is independent of amplification bias. And then using the difference between the UMI molecular count and the initial spiken molecule number, you can also allow the estimation of how much sample material you lost after or during the reverse transcription. Okay. So now we go to probably the most important part, which is then eventually normalization and noise removal. And so again, you will see that the use of spikens can be useful here. So as you know, expression typically needs to be normalized to make samples genes comparable. This is true for bulk RNA-seq, of course, as well. Okay. So why? There's between sample difference, of course. Starting materials can be different. There's differences at each experimental step. You know, several people might be involved. So one does it a bit different than the other. There's, of course, cell states. Maybe one cell is actually dying in apoptosis, or the other one is actually going into G2N phase, right? There's cell cycle differences. Handling reagents, as already mentioned. And of course, the sequencing depths can also be different. You know, if you, for example, sequence samples in two different Illumina lanes, again, it might introduce a bias. And then you also have within sample differences such as gene length and gene GC content. Okay. And so, of course, here we argue, and again, this is true for bulk RNA-seq as well, is that the experimental design is, of course, critical for efficient normalization. And I'd really be happy here to refer to this excellent paper by Hicks et al., which was published actually last year, which really kind of gives you a good overview of how you should actually design your study in order to avoid as much as possible any type of batch effect of technical noise. And so just to make sure that we understand, so basically many people sometimes when I hear them discuss, they actually consider single cells, each of them a replicate. So if you have thousands of cells, one assumes you shouldn't actually design your experiment in terms of batch effects and so forth. This is of course false, okay? So it's actually really good to, for example, divide your cells actually over different runs and try to minimize basically as much as possible any type of technical effects. So by incorporating biological replicates in the experimental design and processing the replicates across multiple batches, the observed variation can really be attributed to biology or batch effect. Okay. So what about normalization then? Well, here you will see a couple of very favorite or popular tools actually that are used to actually normalize population RNA-seq data. For example, you can use counts per total library size, or with TPM transcript per million MAB reads, you can do counts per gene length per total library size, okay, or fragments or reads per kilobase or transcripts per million MAB reads, right? Which is basically, the one is relative proportion comparable across samples, and the other is relative proportions that are not comparable across samples. Anyway, so these are very familiar tools probably to some of you who are involved in bulk RNA-seq. What is the issue now when you're dealing with single-cell RNA-seq? Well, first of all, we redefine in a way what we mean with total library size. This is assuming that you actually use UMIs, because here you can actually, again, get absolute counts, and so you basically can add all the counts derived from the UMI to actually get to your library size, so this is quite different. And so, again, if you use UMIs, we're also assuming that basically you're only sequencing the 3' end of many genes, and so therefore basically dividing by gene length does not make a lot of sense, okay? So typically those kind of methods then you would actually not use. So what actually is then nowadays used, and again there's a lot of problems with those, but it's the best what we have at the moment, is based on total counts, so library size, you know, UMI count if available, upper quartile median, so this is then BC, twin median variance, for example, represented by HR. And so there was an interesting study here in briefings in bioinformatics actually that looked at different normalization approaches. And again, some of the more popular tools, therefore, at this moment, actually for single cell RNA-seq are actually DSeq and HR, even though the entire field acknowledges that they're still basically not the best to deal with actually single cell RNA-seq data. And the assumption for all these tools is that the variation is technical, and that the total amount of RNA processed in each sample is approximately the same. And as already mentioned, of course, this is not the case for a single-cell RNA-seq data, and that's why basically many of these tools are still not very appropriate actually to deal with or to use for normalization issues. So that is a common practice, therefore, if you have spike-ins available, you can derive technical size factors, right? So for example, so you can deal with sequencing depth differences, and you can also derive biological size factors, for example, looking at or normalizing by average gene expression, which then accounts for differences in RNA content, which are directly related to cell size differences. Okay. Over to noise. What about cell-to-cell variability rather than sample, bulk sample to bulk sample availability? Let us have a look here at the right graph. This is basically a meta plot of single cells and a meta plot of other single cells, basically kind of combined together. And what you can see is that this is then reflecting in a way a bulk RNA-seq sample correlation, and this is very good. So you can see that the correlation is 0.92. However, if you take out now the meta out of this phrase and you look at actually the correlation between two cells, what you see is a totally different picture, right? So the correlation is drastically lower, right? And this is actually some of our own data here, mouse adipose stem cells. So what are we actually looking at here, right? Here we have, for example, high magnitude outliers, right? In one cell, basically, they're very high, and others, they're actually lower. We actually have a lot of dropout events where you basically have genes that are simply not present whatsoever in one cell versus the other. And there's also quite a bit of over-dispersion, right? So there's a lot more variation basically between individual cells than there ever would be between bulk RNA-seq data. So over-dispersion, as I just mentioned, presence of much greater variability in a data set than you would expect basically based on a given statistical model. So the observed variance is higher than the variance of a theoretical model. And this then leads me back to what I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, which is there's a lot of dropout events, meaning you have a lot of zeros. So there's a zero inflation, which again has a large impact on many of the tools that are typically used for bulk RNA-seq analysis. Okay. So how can we reduce this noise? Can we tell if the noise is biology or simply technology? If it is biology, is it actually interesting for a question, or is it simply unrelated? And so here is actually a kind of an overview of trying to deal with this kind of variation. Here is the total variation observed. So we want to find technical noise, which can be estimated based on spike-ins or a set of non-variable genes, housekeeping genes. Again, this has huge assumptions, but it's the best we can do. And then here you have biological noise, which could be interesting, for example, arising from subpopulations, which we can detect by clustering. There might be difference in transcriptional kinetics, and there might also be differences because of differences in biological processes, such as cell cycle. And it's therefore the task of the analyst here to actually find out which kind of noise he or she is dealing with, okay? So technical noise, there's been actually ways to deal with that. Again, assuming you have technical spike-ins, right? This is a bit of a busy graph, but let me guide you through it. So here what we plot is basically average normalized read count, and basically here is then the square of the coefficient of variation, right? And the higher something, of course, is expressed, the less you expect this to be highly variable, okay? And so what you can do now is basically also base your overall distribution on the spike-ins, right? So here you have actually spike-ins. You know basically how much you spiked in, so you can plot this very nicely, right? You can also see that some spike-ins are actually completely useless, right? Even in the spike-ins, basically, there's still quite a bit of noise, okay? But at least you can now do actually a technical noise fit, right? And so then you can actually derive a statistical model to select only genes with high biological variation. And this is actually plotted here. So here, basically, you can say and build your own threshold of what you then consider is truly biological versus technical variation. So here in purple, basically, these genes, in a way, go above this threshold of variation. And then, therefore, you assume of technical variation. And therefore, you assume that this is truly biological variation. Okay. So the principle again here is that you estimate technical variation from spike-ins, and for each mean then you expect a certain variation, right, based on these spike-ins, and if that is then if the variation is above this expectation, such as this purple genes here, then this is considered truly biological variation, and these are the genes then you want to look at for further downstream analysis. And again, there's some interesting, for example, here's some single cell latent variable models that actually deal with this kind of noise elimination, okay? So what about biological factors? And again, here there's some interesting studies that have already been done, but I think we're still only scratching the surface. So for example, here this is a study basically that where one looked at T-cell differentiation. And we knew, of course, because of very seminal studies beforehand, that the cells in principle should cluster in naive versus Th2, T helper 2 committed cells as marked by GATA3 expression. But the interesting thing is when one looked at this data, this actually clustering was not observed, okay? So it was really concluded that basically there was a lot of heterogeneity that seems to mask the interesting biology. And so the variant was attributed to different sources, some of it biological, but some of it technical, but then interestingly, one assumed that a lot of variation was also due to differences in cell cycle, okay? And so here, this is illustrated here. So basically here is the observed expression for profile, and whereas you should normally see a nice gradient in color as actually shown in from the naive to the Th2 in the differentiation plot here, these colors you can see they're clearly intermixed, okay? So what was done then basically is to create again this kind of latent variable model to try to actually remove any kind of confounding factor out of the analysis, and in this case this was cell cycle, okay? So when one removed the effect of cell cycle, all of a sudden then the cells actually grouped nicely according to what one would expect, right? So the solution here clearly was the use of these latent variable models to reconstruct hidden factors from the observed data. And this was, for example, based on expression of known cell cycle genes. But that sentence already implies against something. It's known cell cycle genes, right? So here we assume immediately that these are the critical cell cycle genes. We look at how they vary actually across the different cells. We take out that variation out of the equation, and then we actually found the biological significance in our data. But of course, this is again an assumption. Do we actually really know which genes are truly implicated in the cell cycle? And are we maybe throwing out the baby with the bathwater, right? Because taking out variation out of your data set is always very dangerous, right? So again, this is by no means a solved issue. And of course, one can think of different hidden factors such as stress and apoptosis that maybe one also should take into account, okay? So summary here, normalization and noise. So single gene expression, single cell gene expression is noisy. Maybe that's the most important message that I can give you today. Really be aware. And so several approaches have been developed to address diverse aspects of single cell RNA-seq specific requirements in terms of data normalization. But due to the novelty and the diversity of data methods, as I already mentioned, there's currently still no systematic comparison of their performance, in particular in terms of their ability to improve, to provide improvements towards biological discoveries. So I just listed for you, for those who are interested, some possible approaches, but as I already said, I think these will evolve rapidly, and I'm really looking forward to see how the field will deal with this kind of data in the next coming years. Okay. Good. Well, assuming you did a great job, basically, in trying to remove all the technical variation and the noise and so forth, what you really now want to do is to look at, is there actually some biology in my data, right? So here, what you want to do is to look at cell types, identify them, characterize them, do gene network analysis, and so forth, okay? So here you have your actually worked out matrix. These are the genes you want to look out. These are normalized recounts. You did everything properly. So what can you do, okay? So we can categorize this in three types of analyses. The first is cell grouping. The second is finding markers or cell types. And the third is functional enrichment analysis, okay? So let me just focus then first on cell grouping, okay? So there's basically three different labels here again, three different vignettes. So here, the first basically what you want to do is dimensionality reduction. Again, this should be pretty obvious to you. You're dealing with a huge matrix of actually thousands of cells with thousands of genes. This actually presents a highly dimensional data set. And what you want to do is to try to make sense out of it, trying to visualize in a way that basically is intuitive to you. So you want to reduce basically the dimensionality, okay? Then you want to do clustering, and then if you're interested or the data lends itself to it, you want to do cell path and hierarchy discovery, okay? What about dimensionality reduction? So here basically we have two possibilities. Either you actually use linear approaches, right? So this is a linear combination of the variables. So basically you assume here that the data lives close to lower dimensional linear subspace, and there's a couple of popular tools that one can use. Probably the principal component analysis is the most intuitive or the most recognized. It turns out, however, that nonlinear approaches are actually doing very well, so they're getting increasingly popular, and so I will come back to that in a moment. In fact, some of the most used method actually is this distributed stochastic neighboring embedding that I'm going to come back to in a moment. And so with stars, basically, I just indicated here which ones are already employed in single-cell RNA-seq analysis. Okay. So principal and component analysis here, you want, of course, find the direction of maximum variance in your high-dimensional data. And so that allows you then to project the data onto smaller dimensional subspace while keeping the most information, okay? So the principal components are simply linear combinations of initial variables, okay? If you don't really know anymore how PCA works, there's a couple of very cool tutorials here. For example, doing a PCA on a teapot is particularly insightful to understand how it works. So this is, for example, a data set from Barbara Troitlein and Steve Gregg's group. It was published in Nature in 2014, where PCA actually was applied in order to basically visualize, in a way, the data sets that they were actually dealing with. This is for actually mouse lung development. And I'm going to come back to this data set in a moment. Okay. Now, it turns out that basically using non-parametric tools, right, where you actually don't really put a lot of significance to the value necessarily, you just try to actually find ranks, is also very useful actually in trying to visualize the data, and so to project it into two or three dimensions while preserving the high dimensional relationships. The advantage here is that basically it works well with large amounts of heterogeneous data. The negative or the disadvantage is that this is an optimization based method, so there's no unique solution. Yeah. And so the T-SNE, or this method that I already alluded to, this nonlinear method, was actually originally developed not at all for single cell RNA-seq analysis. It was actually developed to simply solve this particular question, which is, can we actually group all handwritten digits of the same type in an intuitive fashion? Okay. And again, here, there's no systematic value you can assign to these digits. You have to somehow sort through all the sixes, which kind of look somewhat differently, to actually make to make sense out of them and say, okay, all of these are indeed sixes. And so this was actually developed in 2008. This method, which actually did a good job in grouping the different types of digits that one was dealing with. You can see this with the color. So each color basically represents a different digit. Okay. And so, not going into too much detail, we can now see already several seminal papers here in the field that actually indeed use this distributed stochastic neighboring embedding, this nonlinear way of visualizing the data, basically, to make sense out of it. For example, cell types in the mouse brain, cell types in the mouse gut, and cell types in the mouse retina. Okay. So, this basically then deals with dimensionality reduction, but of course, this is just to visualize your data, right? What you don't know yet is actually to which cluster basically does each of the cell belong. All it does basically is to visualize different types of clusters, but where does each cell actually belong to? You know, just to kind of point this out here, this is of course highly misleading because it's actually the user or the analyst who actually has colored this, right? In reality, you don't actually have colors from your dimensionality reduction analysis, right? This actually is shown here. Here you basically have the raw data or the raw clustering, and so is this cell now actually belonging to this cluster, or is this cell actually belonging to this cluster? You don't really know, right? And that's what you exactly want to find out using the clustering methods, right? So how to set boundaries between the individual cells? Can we actually systematically group cells into types, which then are represented by different clusters, okay? Yes, you can do this. This is, again, then intuitive for the bulk RNA-seq analysis. Here you can, for example, use hierarchical clustering based on similarities of the data points. And this is, again, this Troitlein-Craig data that I just showed for cell types in the mouse lung. So using hierarchical clustering, this finally then pushed basically cells in different clusters, which actually had to do with the different precursors that actually lead you to a fully functional lung cell. So the typical cell gene matrix here is therefore displayed as a hierarchically clustered heat map. So this works really well. So here you basically have the genes, on the horizontal axis and the vertical axis, this is where you put the different cells, okay. You can also use k-means. I mean, again, there's actually different types of approaches to cluster your data to group these cells into discrete neighborhoods. And this, of course, is based on trying to minimize basically intra-cluster distances here, of course, in the case of cells, and to maximize basically inter-cluster distances, right? So k-means is one of the very many partition clustering methods that one can use, which aims to directly decompose the data in a set of disjoint clusters. And again, there's a lot of different approaches one can use, and I'm not going to be the one who actually tells you to use one over the other. You just have to play around with the data to actually see what works best. Okay. So finally, basically, cell paths and hierarchies. What is actually being done here? So what is the cool thing about single cell data is that you basically can imply some pseudo time, right? If you take an entire organ, which is, for example, under development, it's one snapshot of time in principle. But what you get is actually different cells in terms of their development. Okay. So what you can try to do is to rank those cells basically according to pseudo time, as if basically you did an analysis over an extended amount of time. Here you just do one analysis of all the cells, and then you try to make sense out of the data in a sense that you say, okay, the most likely stem cell I put first, and thereafter actually I try to apply this sort of pseudo time to understand the trajectory of that cell from a basically undifferentiated cell into a differentiated cell. Okay? And so there's again different methods to do so. I'm just going to briefly mention Monocle, but there's also Wonderfall, Waterfall, Wonderlust, Scuba, and so forth, that have been developed exactly to map cell paths and hierarchies. Okay? So again, this brings the point home. So can we actually automatize the building of these different differentiation trees? So here, you need to provide bioinformatics reconstruction of the transcriptomic shift that you actually use them to try to make sense in terms of developmental timing or differentiation timing. Of course, here, the bias is that the user should define what is the first cell, the early cell, or the origin of the trajectory. And so, again, here is, for example, one example where the Monocle framework here was used to actually go from, for example, here in this case, a proliferating cell all the way to, for example, a differentiated myoblast, okay? So what is this using? This is an independent component analysis, right? You see the two different components. And then a minimum spanning tree is constructed. So what you have here is a graph of n nodes, right? And what you then try to build is a tree with n plus one edges that actually have the lowest weight. So we try to find this, the fastest path, so to speak, through your data in order to actually find a trajectory of how, in principle, this cell basically beginning here will move all the way through the different transcriptional states to its end state. And that's what you're actually trying to find. And this is, I think, really cool in something that really single cell analysis allows you to do. So I really am, you know, going actually to the single cell genomics conference last week. There's a lot of new tools that actually are coming online, which seem very powerful. And I think it's going to be exciting to explore those and apply them on the data. Okay. What about finding markers of cell type? Of course, now that you actually have clusters, what you want to know is what genes basically distinguish these particular clusters in terms of their expression, right? And that tells you then about markers. Are there actually markers that really allow you to, for example, identify this cluster over other markers that basically are characteristic for the other cluster, right? So the question here is, I have three groups of cells and I need to find what are the characteristic genes for group B, that is, that have a specific expression in group B in contrast to A and C. So what method should I use, okay? Again, here, it's still very rudimentary. Many of us actually resort to DE-seq and EDGE-R. If you're doing bulk RNA-seq, you will recognize them. There's actually newer tools that are coming online. Here I'm mentioning one from Karchenko et al. This is single-cell differential expression analysis. What is this? This is actually a two-component mixture analysis where you basically use a Poisson distribution to model the many zeros in your data, which is unique to single cells. And then you actually have a negative binomial to actually model the non-zero values in your data to actually better basically model the overall distribution of gene expression values. So again, I expect that several new tools actually will come online to better deal basically with single cell gene expression differences between the different clusters. I'm not going to go into gene oncology. I think most of you probably will be familiar. So once you have actually a set of genes that are characteristic for your cluster, then you can of course do gene ontology enrichment and find out what these genes actually represent, what kind of biological process, what kind of pathway. And this is actually what this tool, Pagoda, is actually really good at. So what Pagoda does, and it actually says in its acronym in a way, it's pathway and gene set over dispersion analysis. So what it's looking for is actually for genes that seem to be co-varying, right? And then it relates that co-variation basically to specific pathways, and then it can actually really find out which pathways seem more enriched in one cluster versus the other. And so this was a recently published paper actually in Nature Methods. Okay. So I'm coming to the end of my talk here. So basically a very interesting and intuitive review also to give you a general overview of all single cell RNA-C aspects as listed here, a genome biology paper that was recently published. Okay, just one little pointer. I think what I try to convince you of is that single cell analyses are highly complex. I think there's still going to be a lot of computational developments required to properly analyze the data. The only thing we argue is that there's probably already some degree of standardization possible that perhaps allows non-engineering users to actually get their hands wet and start doing single cell analysis, because we've heard of many labs that are actually in principle are interested in single cell analysis, but simply feel that they're lacking the bioinformatics skills in order to dive into the data, and so they're actually simply not doing them. And so realizing that, we've actually started to develop a new pipeline, which is basically a SAP in the lab. It's an automated single cell analysis pipeline. Again, it has, of course, its caveats, right? It's nowhere near going to give you the complexity that many of the recently developed tools are providing to you, but we argue that at least some standardization can be done, and you can actually already have some first glances in your data that could already be very interesting, right? So there is existing software out there, but the disadvantage is that this is a restricted set of algorithms and methods. There's a lack of interactivity and visualization. This is very important. It's very difficult to actually play around with your data, to visualize it, to show it to your experimental colleague. The required knowledge of programming and neurostatistics is still very high, and there's the non-standardized inputs, and so forth, right? And so here again, I have to really thank Petra and Besson, who came up with the idea actually to establish this kind of pipeline. And we had a very talented master's student actually who really got his hands wet on developing this pipeline, Adrian Shagovci, a master's student at the EPFL. So what is this pipeline there for? It's ASAP, so it combines state-of-the-art single-cell specific algorithms, which are either written in R, Python, and Java. It's meant to be very interactive and user-friendly with a web interface with 2D and 3D visualization. It has a robust parser for a wide range of input data, so it's really not restricted in that end. There's nothing to install for the end user. We're going to make it possible to install it on your own computer, but in principle, you can use a web interface, okay? It has centralized computational resources, and it's meant to be a multi-user platform, right? So what took considerable time for a skilled bioinformatician at this point, and again, most bioinformaticians will actually dive into the data and provide you with a complexity analysis that goes way beyond this platform, but at least some of the initial steps in your analysis can now be done in a few minutes without any prior bioinformatics knowledge. So what's the pipeline? So here you can, of course, do the input file. This is the read count data, which is already a normalized matrix, but you can also do some normalization within the platform. Then you can actually do filtering algorithms, such as expression-based coefficient of variation. As I said, there is normalization based on simple scaling. For example, if you calculate the average mean across your data from one cell to the next, you can try to scale them accordingly. You can do 2D and 3D interactive visualization, dimensional reduction. You can use clustering, and you can also do some initial differential gene expression. And finally, also, as I already mentioned, in the overall pipeline, gene ontology. So for any user basically now looking online, you're not going to see the video, but I was promised that it will be added at the end of the YouTube video, which will come out. So I want to thank any online user who is watching right now, because it's going to end here. But for those who actually were brave enough to come to the hall, we're going to show you basically how this works in real time by just showing a little video of the entire pipeline. So this is Petra doing this, right? So here basically she has already her matrix, right? In our case, we're interested in adipose stem cells. So this is a text file. We can now upload it, right? We indicate that this is mouse, and now we basically just process it. Here you can do some initial filtering. We actually decided not to do any filtering in this case, right? And so the goal is now that we do generate a working matrix by, for example, doing a scaling, which tries to actually normalize the data across all the different cells. And there's also a little bit of a legend for each. So now this already allows you to look at your data in two-dimensional, even three-dimensional space, okay? And once you've done that, basically, then you can indicate whether you actually want to apply on this data some kind of clustering, right? So here we used PCA. We don't know actually how many clusters we want to use. We use k-means, and we say, okay, maybe between 3 to 8 clusters, let's have a look what the tool finds, okay? So now it's actually processing it. And so what we found basically are 3 different clusters, right? So they're actually colored accordingly. You can zoom in, you can now really play around with the data and already kind of tell you which cells basically. This of course will more be more intuitive, because I'm assuming you will know which cell is in which plate and in which well, at least, right? And then you can actually do gene expression, You can actually visualize certain genes. For example, here you visualize a specific gene in your data if you already have some hunch as to what you might expect to see, right? And here then we perform a clustering on the data. We did hierarchical clustering, which is perhaps the most intuitive, okay? In order to kind of see if we really can now put cells in specific clusters. Here now we see the different clusters with each of the cluster containing a couple of cells. There's actually a third cluster in this case, a fourth cluster, but it only contains two cells. So we kind of eliminate it, or you can assume that this is not really important. And then you can actually do differential gene expression basically on your data to, for example, if you say, okay, cluster one and cluster two, you want to compare them, and it immediately basically gives you a list of genes that are clearly differentially expressed. And then what you can do is the genes that you find differentially expressed, you can look, for example, a gene ontology biological process, and it actually will tell you which process is the most enriched. Importantly, you can actually export all the data, you can go back and visualize it, but you can also save the plots in all kinds of formats. Okay. So this basically concludes this talk. This platform will hopefully soon be online. We're just making it robust enough so that we basically many users can use it at the same time. And so we're hoping to actually do it somewhere in October of this year. So we will keep you posted on that one. But if you would have any feedback on that platform already, there's already some toy data that you can play around with. So you can already get your hands wet, but wait a little bit in order to actually upload your own data. Okay? So with that, thanks for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer some questions.